Listening Library presents She Persisted, Wangari Maathai by Eucabeth Odhiambo and Chelsea Clinton. Inspired by She Persisted by Chelsea Clinton and Alexandra Boiger. Read for you by Zenzi Williams, with a letter written and read by Chelsea Clinton. This book is dedicated to my mother, whose commitment, kindness, and community involvement reminds me of Wangari.
Dear reader, as Sally Ride and Marion Wright Edelman both powerfully said, you can't be what you can't see. When Sally Ride said that, she meant that it was hard to dream of being an astronaut like she was, or a doctor, or an athlete, or anything at all, if you didn't see someone like you who had already lived that dream. She especially was talking about seeing women in jobs that historically were held by men. I wrote the first She Persisted and the books that came after it because I wanted young girls and children of all genders to see women who worked hard to live their dreams. And I wanted all of us to see examples of persistence in the face of different challenges to help inspire us in our own lives. I'm so thrilled now to partner with the Sisterhood of Writers to bring longer, more in-depth versions of these stories of women's persistence and achievement to readers. I hope you enjoy these chapter books as much as I do and find them inspiring and empowering. And remember, if anyone ever tells you no, if anyone ever says your voice isn't important or your dreams are too big, remember these women. They persisted, and so should you. Warmly, Chelsea Clinton.
Chapter 1. Born to the Land. When Mount Kenya's snow-capped peak was covered with a blanket of clouds, the people knew the rains were coming. The rains that filled the rivers and streams. The rains that gave life. One very special life came into being during that season. Wangari Maathai was born on April 1, 1940, during the rainy period. Her childhood was woven through with the flowing rivers and streams and the animals and people of her bountiful country. As soon as Wangari was born, everyone sprang into action. The women formed a circle of loving care around mother and baby. They made a nourishing meal from the choicest vegetables in their gardens. Even before offering her baby milk, Wangari's mother chewed small bites of roasted bananas, sugarcane, and sweet potatoes into a smooth juice. She put the juice into her baby's tiny mouth, sharing the strength of the land and their community. Wangari was born in a small village in Kenya called Nyeri, a part of the country with lush green shrubs, ferns, and trees. There, the rain fell on the nearby fields of blue-purple sugarcane, on the forested hillsides where animals like elephants, leopards, antelopes, and monkeys made their home, and on the grass-thatched roof of the separate hut where Wangari's father prepared another feast to celebrate the birth of their first daughter. The same rain that caused everything to grow seemed to welcome baby Wangari into her new world. That same rain would help provide food for her to grow like a strong tree, and bringing back the trees would be her reason to fight to heal the land. Wangari's parents, Muta Njugi and Wanjiro Kibisho, were Kikuyu people. Life for the Kikuyu revolved around nature. They believed that Mount Kenya, also known as Kirinyaga, or Place of Brightness, was a sacred place. They believed that God, Gai, lived there and provided everything they needed, the land, the rain, the plants, and the animals. As long as the mountain stood strong and steadfast, they believed that God was with them. Little Wangari toddled after her two older brothers and her mother, imitating everything she saw. Like most African girls at the time, Wangari learned from her mother. Known as Lydia, she sewed clothes for her family and gardened. Wangari would watch as she, with the help of woman relatives and friends, regularly roofed their grass-thatched hut. When Wangari was growing up, Kenya was under the control of the United Kingdom. Life was hard because of the British colonists. The British didn't respect the land and traditions and imposed their own way of life on the people. People in Kenya suffered as a result. The British colonizers cut down trees to clear huge fields for farming, brought in different types of plants that ruined the soil, and hunted the animals that shared the land. The Kenyan people had to follow the laws of the landowners who now ruled them. Instead of having small farms that grew just enough for each family, many people were displaced and had to work on large plantations run by British colonizers. Others needed to work to pay the taxes introduced by the British government. Christian missionaries tried to change the beliefs of the people, preaching that God did not dwell on Mount Kenya, but rather in heaven. When Wangari was very young, her father left the village to work on a plantation in Nakuru, 100 miles away. Not too long after that, Wangari and her mother left the forested hillside where she had been born and followed him to a vast, flat valley planted with field after field of wheat and maize. When they left Nyeri, Wangari left behind everything she knew, but she was too young to worry about what it would be like where she was going. She felt safe because her mother was with her. Chapter 2. Glorified Slaves. Wangari was 3 years old when she got to Nakuru, and there she joined in the flow of life like all her other siblings. She was eager to help as best she could. She cared for her two younger sisters, Murugi and Washada, while her mother planted wheat and maize, plucked weeds, and harvested crops in Mr. Nealon's fields. As she got older, Wangari also did household chores and ran errands, like fetching their family's daily ration of maize flour and a liter, a little more than a quart, of milk that was their payment for the day's work. Wangari and her family, along with others, lived as tenants, called squatters, on Mr. Nealon's farm. They were required to work in exchange for flour and milk. They never went hungry, but they lived like glorified slaves. That means that they were treated harshly, like enslaved people were, but they could leave if they wanted to. Many people did not leave, though, because their land had been taken by the British and they had nowhere else to go. There were no schools for squatter children at Mr. Nealon's farm or even nearby. Wangari stayed busy helping support the family. While taking care of her sisters, she would cast her eyes to the fields around her, where older children picked beautiful pyrethrum flowers used for making insecticide, which was an insect-killing spray. Wangari dreamed of joining them because it looked like a pleasant job. Wangari loved the open fields where she felt free to enjoy nature. She would gaze at the endless fields of wheat, watching and listening as the wind made waves through the knee-high grasses. After maize harvest, she and her siblings grazed their goats and sheep in the freshly cut fields and feasted on the small, yellow, juicy managu berries. She would eat so much that she would be too full to eat supper when her family would enjoy the leaves of the managu vegetable as their meal. One day, her father called her. It was not a common thing for him to call her. She wondered what he had to say. "You are going to Nyeri, so you can help your mother take care of your younger sister," he told her. So Wangari, her mother, and one of her younger sisters returned to Nyeri, where her two brothers had been living in the care of their uncle Kamunya, so that they could attend school. Her other younger sister joined a bit later as well. Wangari was happy to go back to Nyeri as long as she was with her mother. Nyeri was even more beautiful than Wangari remembered, full of all shades of green. Vegetation covered the fertile brown soil. The snow-capped Mount Kenya seemed to stand guard to the north, and there were even more mountains to the west. Green valleys dotted with bananas, yam, arrowroots, and sugarcane gardens spread before her. She took a deep breath, drawing in the fresh highland air. She was back home. Wangari had many things to relearn. For example, at 8, having spent 5 years in flat Nakuru, she did not know how to go down a steep hillside. She watched her cousins and brothers run down the hill. At first, thinking she would fall, she crawled down the hill backward. But before long, Wangari was mud skiing just like her cousins. The children were encouraged to play in the rain and hailstorms because it was believed that the rain would make them grow the way it made plants grow. Wangari wanted to grow as tall as a tree. As she grew up, Wangari continued to do chores just like her mother and the other women in the village did. She would go
into. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.